right, so I want to do a kind of more focused tutorial video on how to use the gun, which, if you're interested in the A-10, is probably why you might be here. You want to know how to use this thing right here. Now, there have been a lot of there's a included tutorial that comes with the plane when you buy it. There are several videos in existence already that kind of tell you how to do this. What I want to focus on, though, don't need to take in right now, is how to pop a T-72 in one pass. And the damage model in DCS is a little funky, so, and they are reworking it, so this is not intended as another complaint video, because there are plenty of those. There are plenty of posts on the forums as, "Oh, the damage model's broken." Yes, we know, and we also know they're fixing it right now, so don't worry about it. It'll be, I'm sure it'll be fine. But in the meantime, how do we kill tanks? If you're interested in kind of the damage model aspect of this, and first off, I want to preface this by saying do not evaluate your performance based on the numbers you see in the debriefing in DCS. If you want to know why, I've got another video I'll probably link to the description that shows exactly why. Basically, if you get attack view and look at your actual rounds fired and rounds that hit, you're hitting with a lot more than the 5 to 20 that the debriefing is telling you. I think the debriefing tends to cluster those strikes together in groups or something like that. So don't look at that and say, "Oh, gee, I only hit the tank 5 times," when you shot at it with 600 rounds. That's garbage. You probably hit it something like 400 times. So keep that in mind when you're looking at your scores and, "Hey, gee, what the hell going? What the hell? What am I doing wrong here?" For an actual good review of how you did, download Tac View. It's free, and just dive into it, and we'll do that after this mission here. So back to the subject at hand here, we are going to arm the gun and the master arm switch. Master arm on, that means we can fire weapons in general, and gun, now this is an interesting switch, gun slash pack, this is gun arm. Okay, a little bit about ballistics here. As you know, bullets do not travel in a straight line, and they also cause effects into the launching system, whether that's your shoulder when you shoot a rifle, or the whole aircraft when you're shooting something with it, something that carries a gun as massive as the Avenger, the plane's going to do stuff. Specifically, the A-10 likes to pitch up when you fire the gun. So what the PAC does, that stands for Precision Attitude Control, and it depends on these augmentation systems and some other stuff. When you fire that gun, it compensates for that recoil. It'll hold that pipper right rock solid onto the target. So if you have a Thrustmaster Warthog, you'll have a two-stage trigger, just like the actual A-10 does. When you pull in the trigger to the first stage, it'll engage PAC, and when you squeeze it all the way, you get PAC 2, which means your gun is firing. I don't have the Warthog. I've got a CH product stick, so I have a second button bound to PAC. So what we're gonna do, I've got 10 T-72s down here at this firing range. So to get ready to fire your gun, obviously you're gonna arm your, I like to keep this on gun pack. The only time you really don't want your pack on is if you have something that's all scattered around, like infantry, and it'll cause a wider dispersion pattern. Since they're lightly armed or lightly armored, they only need like one strike to kill them anyway. Armor needs a lot of strikes, and we'll go into why. excuse me. We're going to hit the master mode switch to turn the HUD into guns mode, and you can see our gun sight down here. And that's the default gun sight. Looks kind of like a clock. And you notice it has two pippers, one here and one here, and that's because combat mix the A-10 carries is two separate kinds of projectiles. One's heavier than the other and has higher bullet drop, and that's the second pipper, and this is the lighter. And as you dive and get closer to the ground, you'll see this number here. This is slant range. If I drew a laser beam from my nose to the ground, it would be 4.9 miles away, 4.7. And as you close to the ground, these pippers get closer and closer together because their trajectories intersect. So if you really want to hit something hard, you want to get both of those pippers, close together. Also note that, you know, guns are not laser beams. They do not shoot projectiles in a straight line. And while the bullet's traveling through the air, it's affected by gravity, of course. Wind, the density of the air, all kinds of funky stuff. So, the faster the projectile, the less you have to take that into account, but it is still present. So to compensate for that, what you can do is use this CDU over here. We're not doing it this mission because it has no wind, but you can enter the wind information here into the CDU and it'll correct for that kind of influence on your bullets, not only your bullets, but your rockets, your bombs, all anything unguided. So that's always a good thing to do during your startup sequence. That's another tutorial though. For now, we're going to strafe some tanks. And what you always want to do in the hog, you know, it's known for killing tanks with a gun, but this does not mean that the gun can kill a tank in one pass every time. It doesn't mean that it's a magic anti-tank weapon that always wins. You still have to use it correctly. So what we're going to do is dive on these tanks and try to be as accurate as possible. Get our pipper on the target, engage pack one, and you'll see here when I engage it, boom, see that right here? Pack one, and my plane is holding kind of rock steady while I hold that down, more or less. So when I pull up and down, it kind of wants to correct it and pull it down, pull it back to the point it was facing when I engage pack. Another thing to keep in mind, and this is true for any unguided projectile weapon, whether it's a gun, your P-51s, 50 calibers, unguided rockets, even free-fall bombs, is the flashlight effect. So imagine you've got a flashlight and you're holding it above the ground, you point it straight down. What do you get? You get a circle. That means the little photons of light are all kind of concentrated close to that little circle area, and because they disperse. Again, it's not a straight line. Kind of comes out in a cone, just like the projectiles from a gun. Now, if you take that flashlight and you angle it so it's moving away from you, you notice that image of the light stretches out into a oval, meaning the light is more dispersed across a wider area, and the same thing will happen to your bullet projectiles. So the sharper your dive angle, the more bullets land inside that little circle, which is exactly what we want when we're attacking armor, which we are about to do, and I'll shut up and I'm going to try different gun sights so you can kind of see what the difference might be. I'm going to use the default one here. And you notice, alright, so I'm going to shut up. I'm going to put that top pipper on this engage pack so it holds it more or less on that tank. I'm going to open fire at about 0.8 miles and get pretty close before I break away. And that might have killed it.
Pull up.
Didn't kill it. Okay, this is an issue with... It's an issue. There, I have a whole video on why that's an issue and what's causing that and whatnot. You can see, I almost killed it. What I recommend, you notice that that gun sight is a little cluttered. It's kind of hard to make out the tank and whatnot. So if you make your HUD your sensor of interest, make it soy, press TMS right once, you'll change your gun sight into this handy little cross, which seems to be more popular for killing tanks because it declutters things, and I think it shows the trajectory of the armor-piercing round. When you're killing tanks, you're not really too concerned about the high-explosive round. It doesn't really do a whole lot against the armor, so... Now against lightly armored vehicles, pretty much anything but a main battle tank, that's actually pretty useful. I'm gonna get real close to this guy.
Pull up.
6.5. Just a little kick, that should be enough.
Altitude.
Dead tank. And you'll notice that the tactics I'm using, getting so close to the target before opening fire, would get you almost definitely shot if these were active targets and shooting back at us. So be aware of that. We'll get to that in the next segment. Okay, so I have 750 rounds, which means I shot, see, 11, it took 400 rounds to kill that. Yeah, because you carry 1150, I'm down to 750 now. Normally, T-72s take between 300 and 400 rounds to kill, at least in my little testing runs.
Pull up! Pull up! Altitude! Altitude!
Dead tank. So it is possible to kill them in one pass. What I find helps is to be as... You know, get your pipper on your target as soon as possible, and once it is, engage pack. But you want to be as stable in your approach as possible. If you've been watching any of my other videos, you'll remember the Hawk when I was using the rockets, pretty much in a similar scenario here. What affected accuracy more than anything else was how steady I was holding that aircraft. The same is true in the A-10. So if you're thinking, gee, I don't like the trainers, they're less capable, what can they teach me? Well, there's your answer.
Pull up! Pull up.
Let's get a little close on this guy.
Altitude.
You want to be a little generous with that gun, you know? Boom. Dead. Nice. So, with the damage model in its current state, I find that I have enough ammunition for maybe four and a half dead tanks before I have to fly back and rearm or call in a wingman or what have you. And these are T-72s. The T-80s and the T-90s are going to be thicker armor, so you may have to make more than one run on them or be more accurate or closer when you fire. But again, there's a trade-off between how close you are when you fire, how deadly you are, and how deadly their gunners are going to be too, because they have a little... Yeah, hang on one second. I'll explain that.
Pull up! Pull up!
I'm just going to empty my gun on him.
Altitude, altitude.
Pretty much. 60 rounds left. Oh, look, and he's not dead. So, yeah, see, this shows him only half dead. I don't know why that looked like a pretty good attack run to me. And you'll see in tag view, so far I don't think there's a guaranteed deterministic method to kill a tank. You know, assuming you are doing what you're supposed to, opening fire at the ranges, usually between 0.8 and 0.3 miles slant ranges when you want to open fire and release fire, respectively. So open fire at like 0.8, release at 0.3, usually that's a pretty good probability of kill. That doesn't mean it's a guarantee. The damage model is kind of funky, and, you know, we just have to, work with it for now. And another thing I find that helps a lot is, of course, stability, but the steeper dive angle for some reason. And I talked about the flashlight effect too, but I think it goes beyond that. Let's see, I'm at like a 32-degree dive. And I'm out of ammo. So, steeper dives do seem to cause more death, and I haven't figured out exactly why. Maybe more projectile speed. Because the faster your cannon round is traveling, the more damage it does. Remember, kinetic energy formula is mass times velocity squared. So if you increase your, if you increase your speed by 3, you increase your kinetic energy by 9. So that's pretty significant. So there, 3 dead tanks. I probably could have done a little better on that last one there, but so you get the idea. Can you kill tanks? Yes. Can you kill 10 with one ammo drum? Currently, no. At least I haven't been able to. I'm sure it's technically possible. If you want to wait and get real close and open fire at 0.3 miles, unrealistic, yes. Does it save ammunition? Sure. Okay, so next segment's going to be a little more of a realistic scenario with a mix of different kinds of armor, air defenses, and that kind of stuff. So stand by for attack view and then the second segment. Okay, attack view, here we go. So I'm just gonna fast forward this. And how many tanks did I kill? Oh, I forgot. Recording thing's kinda out of order here. Here I'm talking about ballistics, blah, 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 blah. Nobody cares. Okay, so, boom. Boom, 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 boom. Pretty good run, right? That looked pretty solid, but he didn't die. Look, I fired 294 shots here. Of those, 264 actually landed. So that hit rate is... Oops. 89%. Let's even round it up. Let's give it that. So I hit with 90% of those shots. That's pretty not bad. But it wasn't good enough to kill the tank in one run. And that's what you have to contend with, you know, when attacking heavy armor like the T-72 or even some of the newer stuff. So. Another thing here too, I probably could have fired fewer rounds. If you slow it down and look at the tank itself, it turns gray right about there, and I'm still shooting. So I probably could have saved a few rounds there, but you know, it's better to shoot more. Better to be out of rounds and kill the tank, I think. Okay, this is the one where I actually successfully killed it. Oops. In one pass. So when you know what you did right, it's always good to look at how you did that. So here we go. I am... I want to find range to target here. Sorry, guys. Not that one. Gee, I think I've flubbed this up pretty good. That one? No. That one? No. Third one up? No. Fourth one up? No. Fifth one up. This is horrible. Sorry about this. Sixth one up. That. No. Seventh one up. Yes, of course. So, so that's about 2,900 feet slant range from the target. So, how much is that in miles? About 0.5 miles. So if you want to start firing at 0.6, that might actually be a pretty good idea. Kill the tank. However, you're at risk from all these guys shooting at you, so keep that in mind. My dive angle is about 30 degrees. Indicated airspeed is 373. You can see all that stuff over here. True airspeed is 380. And I am about 1,400 feet above ground level. Burp, 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 burp. Boom. And he's dead. So if you want to save ammo, that's how to do it. And time, sometimes more importantly. So, look at this. Of note, the first tank took over 300 rounds to kill. This one only took 190. And I'm thinking because I had a steeper dive angle and I was closer when I opened fire. So the range does have a significant effect on... seems to have a significant effect on the killing power of those rounds. Boom, got that one too. Similar stuff, 189 hits killed the target out of 227. So that's what, 80% roughly of hit rate. So the thing is, you can do everything right, and the tank still may not die. So if that does happen, don't look at the debriefing screen in DCS. It's going to show you that you only hit it like 20 times or something like that. You look at TAC view, count the rounds here, you know, You're hitting more than you think you are. If you got the pip run on the target, you've got pack engaged, you're diving, you're doing what you need to. The only thing you really want to adjust is when you open fire, how close you get, and your dive angle. That'll help you. So that's that. Okay, segment two, same exact scenario, except that this time we have five main battle tanks, T-72s, and here you'll notice we have a mix of light armor. This one in particular is what you want to be concerned about. That is a ZSU Shilka, which is going to be shooting at us as we're trying to shoot it. We have a BMP, we have a BTR-80, BRDM-2, and what's this, an MTLB. So, you know, just to kind of give you, kind of want to show you how different units react. And what happens when you get shot at. The BMP here is of concern, but of course the biggest threat is going to be this, which is designed specifically to thwart us. Hey guy, how's it going? Anyway, let's get going. So remember range in the gun, right? You have in against armor, you know, anything beyond a mile, yeah, you might hit, but the cannon round's going to have less energy when it makes contact. So is it worth shooting that far out? Maybe. It just depends. Remember, the you're going to do some damage to it. You may have to make more than one run. You may use more ammo. But if you're getting shot at and you really need to strike that tank, you know, you got to do what you got to do. If your mission completion depends on you not losing systems and not getting shot yourself, well, you know, you have to weigh those, you know, risks and benefits. That's just part of virtual combat, I guess, I suppose. Alright, and we're flying in clean configuration. I don't have targeting pod. I don't have ECM pods or any kind of underwing ordnance. That's normally how I find myself when I'm using my gun. In an actual higher threat environment, you have your Mavericks, you have your CBU-105s, you have your GPU-12s and your DPU-38s, all your guided weapons, your standoff weapons. What you ideally want to do is, especially with your Mavericks, use those against, prioritize, first, SAM launchers, second, your Shilkas, and third, you know, once the air defenses are gone, I like to attack the armor, any kind of heavy armor with the remaining Mavericks and guided weapons. And you saw why in that last little segment, because, you know, you don't want to be playing around, you know, strafing T-90s when they're shooting back at you too much. Getting that close is a risk every time. There's no way around that. You know, it's just part of how things go. All right, so let's go into guns mode, and we are going to use this gun sight for lightly armored targets because the HAI, high explosive rounds, actually do matter against them, unlike the main battle tanks. So here we got, I know from the briefing, that's our Shilka, that's our BMP. So these are going to be our priority targets with the gun. And these are some more light armor. These are main battle tanks, and we're going to see how many of those we can kill after we eliminate the light armor. And I'm doing this for a reason, to show that you can, when engaging lighter targets, like the ZSU, BMP, other APCs and that kind of stuff like that, and especially trucks, artillery pieces, anything like that, you can shoot from pretty far out and still get meaningful strikes that will actually kill the target. I expect that ZSU to start shooting at us any second now once it realizes we're here. And here's the deal. Are ZSUs a threat? Can they kill you? Yes. Is your gun more capable than his? Does it have a longer range? Yes, it does. And you can fire from high up. Remember, you have the advantage of shooting from high to low where your bullets are assisted by gravity, and he's fighting against gravity while he's shooting up at you. So that limits his range, limits his effectiveness, and the higher up you are, the safer you are. So what I like to do, this guy's pretty far away, I don't know the exact range, But you roll in. He hasn't started shooting at us yet. There we go. He's got us on radar. I'm going to line up this pipper, and I'm going to give him a little squirt. And I'm going to get the hell out. I don't need to stick around and watch those hits. They're going to do what they're going to do. Apparently he's not dead because he's still pinging us with radar. Now it's natural to want to watch those rounds hit the target and, you know, see how you did. Sometimes it's worth doing that, sometimes it isn't. If you're getting shot at, the priority is to not get hit. See if I can get a little more accurate shot this time. See how those pippers are kind of close together? Oh, and look, the radar shut down. What that means is I probably killed him. So did you see how those two pippers within that gun sight were getting closer and closer together? If you can put the light armor in between those two as they get close together, you're probably going to get a pretty good strike. You can see I could fire from like 1.5 miles out instead of, you know, 0.7, and that gives you a nice little safety cushion. By the time you break away, those bullets may be on their way to you, but you're going to be somewhere else by the time they reach where you were. And believe it or not, all these other light armored vehicles and the tanks and stuff like that, those are a significant threat to you, especially the BMP. A few patches ago, I remember that it was actually more threatening than the ZSU was. I think it's got a 30mm cannon or something like that, and it's pretty accurate. If you look at our RWR here, you saw those little L's. Those are lasers. And I can put a hurting on you if you're not careful. You don't want to get too close to them. But you don't have to. That's the nice part. The pippers are getting closer to each other. And once it gets about 0.4, 0.5, get a good little squirt. I'm going to kind of watch those strikes.
Pull up.
Did I kill it? I did. And you also need less. You need few. See, tracers coming up trying to hit us. Coming up from all over the place. The green ones, I think, tend to be, I don't know. The ZSU definitely has orange tracers. The other ones may have their green tracers. But you can see the light armor, if you're accurate, unlike my first gun round against that Shilka. If you're accurate, and you fire within the right parameters, you can do shorter bursts of gun. Flashlight effect still takes effect. The longer range you are, the more prominent the flashlight effect becomes. So if you're doing this, it does benefit to dive from a higher angle. And again, you know, I'm attacking light armor here, so this is pretty sloppy, actually.
Pull up.
A lot of times in campaigns for the A-10, you'll find yourself tasked out with shooting artillery. That's a good kill. Artillery doesn't take many strikes at all, so, and they typically don't fire back, so you can extend out from probably even beyond 1.5 miles. You might be able to even hit from two or more and get a good kill against those artillery pieces. I'll have to try that. I haven't messed with shooting at artillery in some time, so. Now, really, if you have a group of vehicles like this, just for safety reasons, let's see if we can zoom in and I'll kind of illustrate. We have vehicles here, 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 and here. Now, if I fly straight through the middle of those, every single one has a shot on me. Now, if I attack from the outside and start pecking away from the outsides, like this vehicle, you cut their effective, you know, you're not going to get caught in that crossfire, and there's fewer vehicles shooting at you at one time, which increases your probability of survival. So if you're getting down in the weeds and shooting light armor and stuff like that, it does behoove you to, you know, extend away and attack the closest vehicle to you and not fly through the damn formation, because they're angry, you know, they do want to kill you. And see, look, I've killed 3 light armor vehicles. I still have 810 rounds of combat mix. So against light armor, this gun is, you know, artillery, anything like that, this gun is awesome. So again, use your heavier underwing ordnance for threats like SAMs, AAA, and armor. And then use the gun for lighter targets. You're going to be, you know, I think that's pretty, you know, as efficient as you can get.
Pull up.
Good strikes. Kill him. Let's see. Yep. And that was 80 to 100 round burst. Pretty quick. And you carry 1,100 rounds. Do the math. You can get easily kill 8 to 10, even 11 lightly armored vehicles with, you know, one ammo drum. Pretty cool, right? That number starts going down the more thickly armored the targets are, and that's the benefit of using guided weapons against heavier armor. Gives you more time. Gives you more more ammunition for stuff like this. You know, it's all about killing the most things with the, fewest, getting more kills per sortie. Boom. That should be a kill. And the other thing is safety, because if you have to go, to kill that armor, you're really going to want to get in close, and if you get in close, that's a risk to you and therefore the mission. So you want to use standoff tactics until the threat is low, and then come in. Don't get down in the weeds and start strafing things. All right, so now the remaining targets are T-72s. I'm going to switch my gun sight over to this cross, which seems to help while engaging heavier armor. And we're going to see what happens when we get that close to an armored target while they're shooting back at us this time. So it's quite a different scenario than that clean, easy, non-threatening training mission previously. Another thing, too, just some DCS AI behavior, especially against moving targets. If you land any rounds near, okay, they'll be driving on the road or on their path or even sitting still. If you land any rounds near them, an AI ground unit, they're going to scatter into different positions and stay put for a while. So if you're shooting a moving target and you're like, gee, that's kind of hard, one thing you can do is kind of go, burp, and shoot some rounds near them. They're going to scatter away from the road, and they're going to stop moving, which lets you more easily track them. And you don't have to worry about deflection shooting ahead of them or anything like that. So let's go shoot now. And let's get the hell out of there. Of course, we're turning right away from the rest of that armor. We don't want any part of it. See how they're shooting at us? Now, those guns they're shooting at us are, I think, a 30 caliber machine gun or something like that. So, are they going to hurt you? Yes. Could they kill you? Yes. Look, taking some hits. Now, is it realistic that the guy in the T-72 is going to open the hatch and stick his head out and man that gun out in the open with the hatch open, threatening the inside of the tank as well because of that? While you're shooting him with 30 millimeter, probably not. But that's what's going on in DCS right now, so we have to, be aware, deal with it. And it can end your mission, because, I mean, it might kill you, yeah, but more likely it's going to shut down, systems in your plane, and, if you lose targeting or whatever, of course, that's a bad thing. You can lose your navigation system, you can lose your gun, you can lose your control surfaces, you can, Here's the deal with the A-10, they were like, oh, it's indestructible, it's a flying tank, okay. Yes, it is tougher than other aircraft, very survivable, has redundant systems, Would these help you as a person survive and come back home? Absolutely, and it's totally awesome. Does it mean that after you take hits, you're still at 100% combat capacity? No, it does not. So, yeah, you might be able to fly your hog home after taking some hits and losing your TAD or your targeting pod or whatever, losing your gun. But you've lost the mission at that point, probably, so just take care of yourself. It's just frustrating. You know what I mean? No matter what, you're going to be safe, at least I would hope, sitting at your desk at your computer. You know, the worst thing that happens yet is that you have to do the mission over again. You know, mess with it. I mean, if you want to take the risk, that's on you.
Pull up.
High risk shot. I'm so close. And I'm having a bitch of a time killing this. So the reason I wanted to do this is to show you that while they're shooting at you, it's a lot more difficult to kill tanks. Light armor, easy. Strafing tanks while they're not shooting at you, not too bad. Bit of a challenge, a little bit. You know, you want to make sure you're steady and all that other stuff. But they're shooting back at you like that. Very different scenario. Look, 3 rounds on this guy. Not quite dead. And I've only got 40 rounds of combat mix left. So I'm going to look into attack view after this and see how many times I had to hit this son of a bitch before he decided to give up the ghost. I may not even be able to kill him. But since I've only got 40 rounds left, this is the last strafing run, and I just don't care. Let's just get in as close as we can and make sure all 40 of those hit at close range.
Pull up.
And notice
altitude,
I did take a hit.
Altitude.
I heard a thunk. Yes, my wing has some holes, and the tank isn't... We did kill him, so that's good. So that leaves 4 T-72s remaining. All right, so let's check out attack view and see how I did. Attack view number 2. And we're just going to take off here. Fly to the target range. Now we've got the bubble, deadly umbrella of 23mm coming in here. And check this out. See, I opened fire before I got in range of that cannon. Did I hit him? Yes, I did. I hit him 85 out of 86 times. Of course, that was at a long range, so it didn't quite kill him. I probably could have held on to that burst a little longer and made a one-pass kill. Look, here we go again. Almost in range of him trying to kill me. Got a little closer this time. A little bit of a burst. Him. I fired 86. I fired 82 rounds, but it doesn't show the actual impact. Whatever. It was enough to kill him. So that's... You know, if you run out of Mavericks or whatever and you have to get in close and you've got AAA cannons like that, that's how you do it. You open fire from about 1.5 miles out. Give them about 100 rounds. I think we're shooting this guy here. BMP. Burt. Brr, boom. 86 slugs for that BMP. Fired at pretty long range. Exact range is going to be about 2 miles. 1.8, 1.7, 1.5. So open fire from 1.5 to 1.3 miles. BTR 80. Similar thing here. Pretty much as soon as I got my pipper lined up, I opened fire and broke out. Hmm. See, this is pretty easy money. This light armor really doesn't stand much of a chance against this cannon. Again, you know, we're attacking from the outside in, peck him, you know, we kind of want to peck away at the edges. You know, this area out here is a lot safer than this area up in here. So you come in, you know, kind of snipe it, break away, re-engage, snipe this guy, break away, re-engage. And we did the same thing from this side, from the you know, trying to kill that damn pesky-ass T-72. So that's something to think about when you have to get in close like that. Just because you're in a badass attack aircraft doesn't make you invincible. Now I'm kind of curious how this actually went down, this part here. Boom, boom, boom. Hit it, you know, see they got me there. So I hit him 177 times. Now we saw from other videos that should be enough to kill him or close to it, but it didn't. And that's the effect of range, I think, or maybe just funky damage modeling. It's hard to tell sometimes. 262 rounds fired, hit with 215. So he's been hit with over 400 rounds of 30mm, and he is cruising along like nothing ever happened. But see this? You know, here I'm in pretty good range to kill. But look what's going on here. This guy's shooting at me. This guy's shooting at me. You know, is that realistic? Probably not. Look, I'm getting shot at by all these tanks. You know, you think those guys would have their heads out manning the cannon, or the little swivel-mounted, crew-served, you know, machine gun? Probably not. But they're doing it. You see how much of a threat that can be? So that kind of gives you an idea, and again, that's why it's good to pop the threats with the Mavericks. I've said this probably 40 times. And another thing you can do on these guys is, if you have the CBU-105, you can fly well above their cannon range or whatever, and just drop one kind of in the middle and be done with it. But that's another tutorial entirely, and maybe I'll do that later. In the meantime, good hunting out there. I hope this was helpful to some of you, and you know, have a good one.